It's Fran, again in the lab, at my bench, and I have yet another mysterious display from the early 1960s. It's a form of edgelit display, and edgelit displays had a very brief window of a run in the early 60s. I first saw an edge-lit display in the 1964 production of Goldfinger. They used edge-lit displays for the countdown clock in the bomb that was going to go off in Fort Knox. So around that time, 1964, there was employed, you know, edge-lit displays in some equipment. There was just this little brief window between the electromechanical display era and what was soon to be the era of Nixie tubes and projection displays and pneumatrons and vacuum fluorescent displays and all that other stuff that sort of exploded out of the 1960s. But for a very, very brief period of time, edgelit displays were a practical way of showing numbers in an electronic device. But the little display that I have on my bench right now is a little unusual, even for an edgelit display. Let's go take a look at it. All right, yep, this is it. This is a Stanley Electric edgelit display, and this unusual display comes to us courtesy of Joe Vellis. That's Fran Lab's very own IEE guy. He sent in all that great stuff about the development of the NIMO tube. And thanks a lot, Joe, for sending this one in for us to take a look at. And Stanley Electric is a Japanese company which has been around for more than a century, and they specialize in lamps and lighting devices. I think these days they're pretty much known for doing like automotive consoles, instrument consoles, and headlamps and stuff like that, but apparently they're really big into research about new kinds of lighting technology and such. And in fact, in the movie Back to the Future, the prop builders used Stanley 5-volt incandescent 7-segment displays for the speedometer on the remote control and also on the dashboard for reasons I don't know, but they are Stanley's, apparently. Back in the early 60s, they had a little foray into edgelit displays with this one, and I'll take a zoom in on here. It's got a stack of 7 glass slides that are etched with little dots. You can see them all stacked in there. Oh, there you can see the dots. But it seems like they have an optical coating on them, because there's a kind of a weird kind of optical coating look when you get light glancing off of it. I can't get it for the camera here, unfortunately, but it might be they might be coated, I imagine, to reduce refraction, maybe. But these are apparently rather thin, and they are lit by incandescent lamps, which are on either side, which are supported by these circuit boards. Yeah, it's a big cast metal block for heat dissipation. And there's a metal shell, feels like steel, on the front. And the configuration of this display looks a lot like displays that I saw that were made by nonlinear systems in the early 60s. Which had a very similar kind of setup with the lamps on the outside and sort of had the same kind of form factor as this one. I'll take it apart in a moment, but before I do that, I'm gonna shut off the lights here, and I've got it hooked up to my little transistorized counter driver here. This is basically just a timer board with a decade counter. And then I've got this bank of transistors that I can use. I use this for driving my projection displays, stuff like that, but anything with 10 digits. But because this is a 10-digit counter, and this is a 7-element display, there's going to be a little bit of a pause. It's going to go through the 7, and then there's going to be a pause as it goes to the other 3. I didn't reprogram the counter and all that stuff for this. So, okay, let me turn off the lights and we'll get going. So these characters, they look like the kinds of characters that would be used in a Japanese pachislo machine or fruit machine. Only the number of choices is it's much less. So because usually with a slot machine, you usually have like 22 different characters in a tumbler, and this only has 7. So I can't imagine this was used in an actual machine, but it's sort of perplexing. I was thinking maybe it was like some kind of extra display in like maybe a pinball machine, like a fruit machine themed pinball machine, or some other kind of, or maybe a vending machine or something like that, but there just aren't enough characters in it for it to be in a slot machine, so it's very mysterious. But one of the things that I noted on this one was that because the characters are all sort of different shaped, they've arranged the layers in such a way that the dots don't really overlap too much. If you notice when it goes from like the cherry to the orange, and then it goes from the orange to the star, that each of the characters is maybe a little bit off-center or sort of arranged in such a way that that the dots of one character do not really overlap the dots of another character, and that allows this particular display to be pretty brilliant and bright on all of its different selections, so that if you're not really like super close to it, if you get some distance, the dots sort of merge together and the display actually is pretty crisp from a distance. Some of the lamps are sort of white, I guess, for incandescent. Some are colored green, some are colored red. The red is a very brilliant red. I don't know if it's going to show up on the camera. I'm looking in the monitor and it's just sort of looks orange, but that's like a deep, deep red, and that's an orange, and that's sort of a yellow, and that's another yellow for the lemon, yellow for the bell, and a green for the lime. That's it. Very unique display of unknown origin. I really spent a lot of hours trying to research what this could have come from, but it's just, you know, at least on the internet, it's just a dead end. I wasn't able to find anything. I wasn't even able to find like any resources about the different kinds of displays that Stanley Electric made in the 60s. There was just like no compilation resource. So I guess they're just sort of rare. What I do want to show, though, is I want to rotate this so that you can see the incandescence showing through the top of the, can you see? 1, 2, 3, and you can see the reflection through the inside there of those slides. So looking more on an angle, slides being up against one another, you would get that infinite mirror sort of effect, stronger, I guess, than you do looking at it edge on. But anyway, I thought that I'll turn this off and we'll take a look inside. I had to set up this little converter to go from my little board. I'm going to take off one of these little end circuit boards and take a look there. Really tiny screws. Ooh, yeah, really tiny screws. It's teeny tiny. Yeah. Teeny tiny. Okay. All right. Oh yeah, okay. Here we go. So yeah, little grain of wheat bulbs. These are 14 volt bulbs. And see, it says Stanley on there. But yeah, just a phenolic board, 3 bulbs. Obviously the drawback of this kind of design is that the bulbs are not individually replaceable. it looks like even though this has leads soldered to it, these boards obviously were made so that these would be modular, so that they could be pulled out of a back plane and plugged in, and could plug in a replacement. But pretty much, if a bulb were to burn out on this, it would be intended to replace the whole display. It's not really ideal. Let me get these screws mixed up with one another. These are all machine screws and tapped holes, so definitely a lot of expense went into this. Okay. Oh, yep, here we go. Oh. There's the outer casing. There's the stack of slides. Yeah, look at that. Oh, is that a beauty shot right there? It's a flake of metal. Very carefully. Okay. This is where a microscope would be really handy to show those little dots. One side. See, it looks like those are actually shimmed. There's a little bit of foil on that. That's actually, this isn't glass. This is, I guess that's lucite. It feels like glass, but it kind of looks like glass. It's not acrylic. It's definitely hard to scratch. I don't know what it is. Yeah, see, these are that shim. I wish I had better dexterity than I do these days, but such as it is. Yeah. With some blue tape on it. This is a... Oh, man. Yeah, this was put together with a dexterity that I just don't possess anymore. A lot of people are still commenting in the comments. Oh, does Fran have Parkinson's disease? No. I have essential tremor. It's not the same thing. But for doing this kind of detail work, it's just, well, I give up. I simply don't have the muscle control to be able to put those shims back. Oh, well. Yeah. Just don't have the muscle control to do that anymore. Looks like there's a black piece of board on the back here, just to make it dark. You can see they've staggered the plates in there, again, to be able to hold them in place. And you got these blocks for thermal control, of course. That's it. Together, minus some shims, but still functional. All right, there you go. Well, that's it for this one. Thanks for watching. Also, I want to thank everyone down on Patreon for supporting the channel and making all these videos possible. It's true. Without Patreon, I wouldn't be able to do any of this stuff. It allows me to keep the ads at a minimum. I don't do the crazy mid-roll ads and all that stuff, and you can click to skip the ads as much as you want, because the people on Patreon are the ones who keep the lights on and keep the videos flowing to you. Alright, that's it. I'm Fran. I'll be back here with something else. Something really weird and unusual, maybe. Who knows? Real soon. Alright. Bye! Work. my lap. It's where I work.
At the bench again.